Good evening. The world lately hasn't been kind to India. In the gloom and doom of the global economic slowdown, the India growth story has tasted dirt time and again. And it's not just the India growth story, but also the country's top leadership, which has found itself facing a considerable amount of flak for alleged inaction. Sample this. Standard & Poor, Fitch, Moody's. These are the premier rating agencies of the world, and each one of them in the last few months have revised their hitherto positive outlook on India, in some cases even downgrading India's status. Take global investment banks, for example, be it Morgan Stanley, Barclays or Jefferies, most of them have given out bearish signals with regard to India's recovery and prospective chances of a turnaround. The prickly icing on the cake, if one could call it that, is the recent Asia edition cover of Time magazine, with the almost snarky headline proclaiming the hero of India's first generation reforms as an underachiever. To a lot of people both within the government and outside of it, the constant hum of negativity surrounding India, its political leadership, as well as its economy is surprising, to say the least. Tonight, on The Big Picture, we will try and put our question to our esteemed panel in the most tender fashion. And we will ask them whether India and India's leadership has really lost the grip on administrative, governance and economic challenges. Or is there a subtle machinery at work that would perhaps want the kind of negative sentiment around India to continue? And joining us in the debate tonight will be Amitabh, Mukhopadhyay, former DG of the CAG of India, JAgdeesh Shettigar from the BJP. Also joining us in just a bit will be Nilotpal, Basu, senior leader of the CPI-M. He's already with us on the program, but I'd like to start the show with Amitabh, if I could. Now, Amitabh, not to sound overtly enthusiastic on the whole conspiracy theory overtones in my opening remarks, do you see a pattern here? Does it surprise you that the India story, as well as the people handling the affairs of the country, have come under such heavy foreign media influence criticism?
You see, it's not as if the India story having come slowly to a grinding halt almost was not going to evoke such sentiments everywhere. But on 12th June, BBC wrote a very uncomplimentary piece by Shomik Biswas. Hmm. Immediately it was followed up by other journals, and now the underachiever tag that Time magazine has given to Manmohan Singh. So there does seem to be a kind of change in the understanding of the foreign media of Manmohan Singh. Early, I say this because earlier they used to applaud Manmohan Singh for being a gradualist in reforms, in contrast to the Latin American cases where reforms failed, liberalization failed. Now they seem to be not so happy with his gradualism. Mm. And I think it is also a kind of situation which is precipitated by the global economic crisis, especially the euro crisis at the moment, where India's, what is expected from India is to bear a lot of pain, bear a lot of inflation, bear a lot of reduction in deficits and so on, so that, in order that the global economy can revive.
Right.
So there's a lot, Manmohan Singh's image has a lot to do with all that he has, the constraints he has to face in trying to...
We'll get to the image of Manmohan Singh in just a bit. I'd like to get another perspective in before I come to Mr. Shettigar. Nilotpal Basu has joined us. Thank you, Nilotpal, for joining us. I know you're going to say that the UPA's economic policies since 2004 have been anti-people, and they've sort of given away and thrown away whatever little goodwill they had earned after UPA won. But my question, of course, is to you, do you see a marketing machine or a subtle agenda at work here? Are you going to stick to the problem, stick to the line that there is a problem and the people handling the economy have bungled up? Are you going to stick to that line, or is there something more to it that you would like to add?
No, first of all, there are two aspects which has to be taken note of. I think India has her own problems, and Indian people in any case are bearing the brunt of the brand of reforms that was initiated by Dr. Manmohan Singh from the beginning of the 90s. And I think we have come to a stage where this entire finance capital driven bubble that was created has now come bust, and as a result of that we see all this current account deficit and all that. And in the background of this, what is being attempted is to further squeeze India and the Indian reformers to go for a more right-wing shift. Therefore, within the country also, we are hearing this cacophony about policy paralysis and all that. They are not concerned about the inequalities that have come up and the corruption and the erosion of real income of the people and all that. They are just trying to extract a greater pound of flesh, and it is the global lobby of neoliberal policy makers who have created a mess for themselves and would like to import some of this mess to India to further accentuate the degree of difficulty that the people have already come to face.
Nilotpal, you're saying basically that the scandals that have plagued this present government, of course, really haven't helped either Dr. Manmohan Singh's image or the government's image as a whole, and they have in fact contributed to this sort of tarnishing of India's image abroad. We'll get to Nilotpal Basu in just a bit, but let me come to JAgdeesh Shettigar for a bit. From an economic standpoint, sir, do you see the problem as it is today being compounded by the fact that international agencies and to a large extent the international media seems to have turned on India rather quickly?
No, as far as the rating agencies downgrading India, it is a debatable issue. I fully don't agree with that. But when they point out the reasons for the problem, now we cannot disagree with that. What is the ground reality and all? I mean, I am not even bothered about the which direction one should initiate a policy, whether it is the reforms or the another direction. The first of all, to economy to perform, there has to be action. The policy measures has to be initiated. Today, we are concerned that because there is a what you call the policy paralysis or the governance deficit. So this is what is worrying. There is government is simply not functioning. Whatever may be the reason, whatever may be the, maybe the because of the environment the created, which resulted in uncertainty in terms of the political stability. Now that resulted in the government machinery not functioning. In fact, the data shows that the economic decision initiated by the government has come down drastically. The investors are worried about that, whether it is the case of the foreign investors or our own domestic investor, they lack confidence. In fact, the top five companies sitting with more than 80,000 crores of surplus cash, still they are not prepared to invest because of the uncertainty, which is as a result of the government is not in a position to initiate or the take action. Now, with regard to the Time magazine, now it is a debatable issue whether Manmohan Singh should be dubbed as an underachiever. Because personally, I don't agree with that.
Right.
The underachievement, it should be the government, because in the
space, you're saying personally pointing out
It's the entire government is underperforming. As far as the putting the blame on Manmohan Singh, I think they should understand the system within which this particular UPA government is functioning, because they are experimenting with the new system of the leader controlling somebody, leader performing through somebody else.
Fair point, sir.
So
fair
that
point.
Is why this system itself is a debatable.
Fair point. Let me go to Amitabh really quickly. And this is probably the crux of our argument today and the debate topic as well. Could this perhaps, Amitabh, and I'm choosing my words rather carefully here, be a concerted attempt at by lobbies and powerful industrial cabals around the world to add to the already elevated levels of pressure that the government is feeling to revive long-pending reform-oriented policies?
You see, it could be, to some extent, there is a bid on the part of foreign countries, the Western developed countries, to try and pressurize both China and India into acquiescing to a currency regime which they had dominated so far, and a currency regime in which China has in fact been trying to push its rights of and legitimacy of the yuan to come in.
Right.
Now both these countries, China and India, have instead of trying to fight or confront the Western countries, they have basically placed their faith in the IMF, which is why a huge amount of money was pledged at the G20 by Manmohan Singh.
Right.
They are going the IMF route, that if you strengthen IMF, then the surveillance, then the kind of equality, the issues of that can be ironed out in a multilateral forum rather than India or China being pressurized to do this or that. Mm. You must recall in the earlier, the concern in G20 was about China not devaluing its currency to the level that it should, in their opinion, be at.
Right, right.
It used to be the issue of currency rather than the European economic crisis which featured this time. Hmm. But on both occasions, I think, Manmohan Singh or this government has been able to hold firm to its way of being able to get some support through a through strengthening a multilateral agency, the IMF.
Right.
So I feel that there is a hint in the kind of cascading number of articles against Manmohan Singh which is happening. It is as if they're trying to suggest that their very agent to steer India towards
sort
America
of let them down.
Has sort of let them down.
Right, right.
So, but that's not the case.
Right.
I think Manmohan Singh has better credentials than just being
absolutely, absolutely. And anyone would agree with that. Let me put the same question to Nilotpal, Basu. Sir, do you agree with what Mr. Amitabh Mukhopadhyay just said on the show? And my question to you, of course, would be that could this perhaps be a deliberate effort to increase the levels of pressure that the government feels to revive the economic reforms agenda, so to say, and perhaps this IMF-centric approach? Do you agree with that theory at all?
I don't simply because if you see in explaining the present predicament which Indian economy has come to face, that actually the Indian economic think tank is not explaining this to the people, that say, for example, the burgeoning inflation that we face is actually imported from the global processes. So unless we take a route, as in the case that China is doing, you will recall that Mr. Mukhopadhyay was talking about this currency war. Now, when dollars were coming in very liberally, the Brazilians and the Chinese had actually imposed a transaction tax whereby they have been able to ward off and firewall their currency from the present downslide that Indian rupee faces. Similarly, on the question of inflation, if we look at, you will find that excess demand in India, which is being used by the present think tank led by Manmohan Singh to explain the inflationary situation, is absolutely misplaced. It is actually global excess of demand resulting from the recessionary crisis which has been imported to the Indian situation. So I think while I agree with one part that there will be a further attempt to further bamboozle India, to further undermine India, to take some kind of an independent position as the Chinese are taking. On the other hand, there is also the blame to be apportioned to the Indian government led by Manmohan Singh himself, because by giving the kind of explanation that they are giving, they are actually strengthening these forces.
Right.
So
I mean
it's a really combination of the own undoing and capriciousness of global finance capital that these things are happening.
Right, right. Nilotpal, I will come back to you. Just a very brief question to you, sir, before we go into a break now. Now, these agency ratings are indicators that investors normally look towards and to follow. But if not India, then who? I mean, apart from China, perhaps, sir, there are hardly any investment destinations in the world that are quite lucrative right now. India is a huge market. If not India, then who? Doesn't that prove that even though the fact that India is better off than countries like Spain and Portugal, how do you explain the rating of India is lower than Portugal and Spain? Isn't there a red herring there?
No, that is why in the beginning itself said, as far as the rating agency is trying to downgrade the India is concerned, there must be vested interest, because when our investors go to the international capital market, they have to pay higher interest rate. There may be some, the conspiracy with that. But now with regard to the Time magazine opinion, we cannot say that they are trying to put pressure actually. It is just an opinion. Now, before dismissing that, we should also look at ourselves, what is the ground reality. Now, if you look at the GDP growth during the last quarter, it has reached the lowest level during the 9 years.
5.3,
and
yes.
Even the investment. Forget about the other policies. Mm-hmm. Now, coming to the inflation, I'm sure that no government would like to have inflation. Everybody knows the what he called the adverse effect and the political price they have to pay. But still, here is a situation. You have got a food stock of more than 65 million tons. It is a more than 45 million higher than the your storage capacity. Mm. Now, why can't you simply release the food grains to the market? It would have automatically brought down the prices in the market. Still, why you are not doing? That means that some vested interests are being supported by somebody in the government. So that is what, when we say that the Prime Minister doesn't have the control, These are the things like small things.
Right.
He doesn't
these
have
add
the
up.
Control.
These add up. Absolutely. We'll take a small break right now, gentlemen. We'll come back. Rajiv Kumar, Secretary General of FICCI, will join us after the break. We'll talk about industry perspective and how industry perceives the negative criticism coming the Prime Minister's and the government's way. Don't go anywhere. Stay tuned to The Big Picture. Lots more coming up on the other side of this break. Welcome back. You're still watching The Big Picture. And joining us now is Rajiv Kumar, Secretary General of FICCI as well. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us on The Big Picture tonight. Let me come straight to you and straight to the point. Rajiv, give us a sense of how you see this issue. Negative press for the PM, who is and has been, let's face it, the face of globalization and its India's reforms and subsequent economic gains for a while now. Now, that negative press for the PM can only harm investments and harm growth. Your take on whether the problem is so direly acute as the foreign media machine is portraying it to be?
Well, I don't give much credence to what the foreign media says or not says about our leadership, because it doesn't matter really to me. And also I can assure you, it doesn't matter to the investor community either in India or abroad. What really matters is as to what we are actually doing on the ground. And I am very happy to note here that the Prime Minister and his colleagues, cabinet colleagues, have now, started refocusing on the growth. That, they are talking very clearly about the measures that are on the anvil, which will be taken. And I'm really just hoping, and I'm quite, it looks as if that they will be, they will be walking the talk as well. So honestly, the media is good today, the media is bad tomorrow. These things don't really matter.
Right.
And I'm sure those who have read the Times story will realize that it is actually the concrete steps that you take on the ground which affects the investment climate and not the media. Stories.
Right, Rajiv, but a supplementary follow-up for this question. How do you explain, forget the Time magazine cover, forget the press, forget the bad press that the PM is getting. What about rating agencies like Fitch and Moody's and S&P? They've also their outlook has changed over the last few months. And how does one rationally explain, Rajiv, that countries like Portugal and Spain that are on the brink of economic collapse, and India is far better off than them, even they are placed higher than these rating agencies? Do you not see a pattern there?
Well, I am quite reluctant to see conspiracies anywhere, actually, Athar. And that's not something that I really sort of normally fall for. Ruling the conspiracy theories out, what I do see, however, is that India has become a kind of a favorite, sort of whipping boy of these rating agencies and the media.
Right.
Which, as you rightly said, There is no way that India is in a, you know, India has anywhere near to defaulting on its international commitments, or that our reserves are not high enough for us to meet our international liabilities. And our public debt to GDP ratio is also well within control. Mm. And actually, our external debt is a mere 22% of the total GDP. Mm. So I don't know why there is this some sort of a concerted effort at this time to turn in a very negative picture about the Indian economy, which is still, by God's grace or by our effort, growing at 5.3% in the last quarter. Mm. Now, the only reason I see here is that the foreign investors have taken some recent steps taken very badly. And that is what is driving them and their interlocutors, whether it's the credit rating agencies or the media, towards, you know, portraying this rather bleak and negative picture about India.
Right, right.
But, everybody is prepared, in my view, to give the benefit of the doubt to our economy, because the long-term strengths remain in place.
Right.
And as long as that is true, the investment will come back, provided, of course, and that's a big provided, of course, that the measures that are expected to be taken, which are promised to be taken, are now taken as soon as possible.
They come through. Rajiv, stay with us. We'll come back to you for further comments in just a bit. But let me read out, Amitabh, this is for you, a satirical article in the Wall Street Journal that I read. Imagine the scenario where one of the PM's aides say, and this is why I chose the word snarky in my introduction, and this is all hypothetical. I quote, "It has been said that Manmohan Singh is an overrated economist and underrated politician. After 8 years as Prime Minister, half of that statement remains true. This is quite an achievement." This is the same publication that has hailed the same man over and over again over the past 20 years. How do you view this? How do you view the certain turnaround?
As I said, I mean, my understanding of this is that the Western countries are getting a little more desperate about the kind of assistance that they need from the emerging markets. And the government of the day in India, for instance, there have been, I mean, I wouldn't say Manmohan Singh is an underachiever, but I would definitely say that India is an underachiever. All of us are underachievers to the extent
that we haven't realized our potential.
We have not been able to put in place leaders, a leadership through parties, through an electoral system, where we have responsible leaders who don't hold back something like FDI in multi-brand retail, who don't try to pull the rug each time the government in power needs to do something. Mm. And I must make one point here very clear.
That briefly, sir.
Manmohan Singh is the only political leader, and I repeat, he's the only political leader to my mind who understands that India is competing in a global economy. Whether it wishes to or not, it has to do that.
Right.
And our employment can be stolen by other countries,
right,
by competitors. So it's a very urgent kind of scenario within which Manmohan Singh sees the whole business of being able to earn a livelihood and have some dignity.
Right, right. Point taken, sir. Let me go quickly across to Nilotpal Basu. Sir, briefly, if you could, the question I'm asking you is this. Even if the Prime Minister made a rather unflattering Time magazine cover, does it influence public opinion in India to the extent that we blindly paste that headline to our minds without checking the facts first? Is it a sort of a inferiority complex that we have? What would have happened if the same headline was in some Sri Lankan daily or some Pakistan daily? Would we take it as seriously?
I think in any case, these foreign journals, what they are saying, that doesn't matter. What matters is the objective experience of the Indian people. You see, I was a little amused at Mr. Mukhopadhyay's observation that foreign direct investment in multi-brand retail is to be allowed, and those who are not allowing that, they are doing a disservice to the country, and so on and so forth. My point is, after all these years, this single point growth-centric obsession of the corporates, of economic think tank, what we are actually finding in this last 20 years, growth has become synonymous with the growth of profit. I mean, if you break down the composition of our GDP, you will find that constantly there is an erosion of the labor component, of the wage component of the GDP, and there's a constant growth of the profit component of the GDP.
Right, right.
So ultimately, to most of the people in the country, I mean, unless that GDP growth translates into improvement in their quality of life, they are going to dump Manmohan Singh anyway. And that is the political trend that we are seeing all over the country.
Right, right.
And what kind of employment will be saved by FDI in multi-brand retail also, I don't understand.
Right, point taken, sir.
The experience all over the world is completely the opposite.
Point taken, Nilotpal. Basu, thank you so much. Very briefly, sir, Mr. JAgdeesh Shettigar, if I can ask you the same question. Are we as a country giving too much importance to magazine covers and not looking at the fact? Is that something we suffer from as a nation?
No, as far as these discussions, whether it's a drawing room discussion or the TV studios, let alone the Time magazine's comment, I think we should not bother too much, because as far as the critical issues like inflation, when the housewife goes to the market, she feels the pinch. And similarly, when the educated youth looking for the job opportunity, today, because of the recession, already the companies have started cutting down the recruitment. So it is not what we discuss or what Time magazine writes that is not an issue. At the ground level, how the common man, that is whether it is a educated youth or the housewife, feel, that is a crucial. And for that, they know the what exactly is the situation, and ultimately they show that it will be reflected when the at appropriate time.
So we are almost out of time, but I'll give the last word to Rajiv Kumar very briefly, very quickly, sir. Does India, in fact, Rajiv Kumar, need a reboot? And do you have the confidence in the man at the helm that he will deliver what is required? Briefly, sir.
India does need a reboot. India needs a reboot very urgently. We will otherwise drift into a crisis. And yes, I still have the confidence in our Prime Minister, because I worked with him and I know that he knows what is to be done, and I'm sure he will find now the space and the acumen to do it, and also he'll build the necessary coalitions, because I know that he recognizes that without building the necessary coalitions, he cannot take the reform agenda forward.
Right.
Just one last word for Mr. Basu. He should recognize that in 1978, in China and West Bengal had the same per capita income and the same level of industrialization. 33 years later, China's per capita income is about 5 times that of West Bengal.
Right, right.
And that was achieved because China paid attention to growth and had 3 decades of 9% rate of growth, and therefore eliminated poverty.
Right.
So those who don't put attention on growth and those who don't talk about growth actually suffer the sort of fate that we have suffered in comparison to China. So let us just emulate China and put our attention on growth. Everything else will come after that.
Right, Rajiv, I have to stop you there. Thank you so much for joining us on The Big Picture. Rajiv Kumar there. Of course, Nilotpal Basu, thank you so much for joining us on the program. Amitabh Mukhopadhyay as well as JAgdeesh Shettigar. Of course, putting too much importance, giving too much importance to magazine covers is not where it's at. That's not the way to go about it. Like Rajiv Kumar just said, the man at the helm is the absolutely right person to take us through this economic crisis. And he and the industry still have faith in the Prime Minister to deliver, even if he has critics all over the world. Thank you so much for joining us on The Big Picture tonight. Till next time, when we get you another edition of The Big Picture with another hot topic, this is Athar Khan saying goodbye, good night, and thank you for watching.